Some substance by density of another substance.
So density of substance by density of water.
So this is a comparative term. So here we come to the units. So SI unit. What is SI? System International or International System of Units. Okay. So SI unit. Unit of mass is what? Kilogram. And unit of volume is meter cube. Okay. Meter cube. So, or the same thing you can write kg meter power minus 3. If you are asked for the CGS, okay, CGS unit of density, not relative density. So, what is CGS? Centimeter gram second. Yes or no?
Right.
So, in the place of kilogram, we will get gram per. In the place of meter cube, centimeter cube, cubic centimeter, cubic centimeter, cubic centimeter. The same thing is also called as cc. 1 cc or 1 cubic centimeter is equal to, if it is equal to milliliter, 1 ml. Understood. So you might have come across this word CC in daily life. Where did you or where you might have? Just think of bikes, vehicles. Okay. Mostly, suppose for example, you take some bikes like Hero, Honda, Splendor, Passion, etc., etc., etc. Okay, Bajaj Platinum, TVS, etc. So, you might be seeing a terminology called as 100cc or 110cc or 150cc, 200cc, okay, 500cc, 1000cc, 1000cc. And between 750cc also is there. So what is this cc? This cc is nothing but the cubic centimeter only, volume of the engine. Engine capacity, and only engine capacity we will be mentioning like this. So if you are doing the servicing, you might have come to know about this cc. So how much engine oil has to be poured in a bike of 100cc, 100 ml. Okay, if it is 150cc, 150 ml. If it is 200, 200 ml. Otherwise, one liter. So this is the terminology where you come across this cc in our daily life. So examples of this you know very well. Okay, so I need not keep this from here. Okay, so that is about cubic capacity also we will say. Cubic capacity, right? Okay, then cubic centimeter. Here our discussion is regarding CGS unit of density. So we can write this also as gram per cm cube power minus 3. Right. So actually, I'll tell one general thing now. So there are two difficulties. That means while taking the class, for any teacher, how much of expert the teacher or the lecturer or the person might be. For any such a person, two classes are very difficult to conduct. So what are they? What are they? Okay, first one is the class before lunch. Okay? The class before lunch is very difficult to handle because people will be hungry. So just before the lunch to handle the class is very difficult. And the second, because when it is hungry, even if you teach Bhagavad Gita, Quran, whatever, people are listening like this, as if they are, maybe, of course, very few might be able to concentrate, but it is difficult to concentrate. So that is one, the toughest class for any teacher, right? The second one is the class after lunch, just immediately after the lunch. So these two are very difficult. Why difficult after the lunch? Means as you have had your lunch, so the process of digestion will start, and slowly the digestion process will be going on, and some effect hormones are released, and also the fans are there, otherwise fresh air will be coming from outside. So very cool atmosphere, and our brain, what it says is, come on, take some rest, man. This person will be telling everything, maybe something like this. You can carry on. So most of the, even ourselves, even the teacher, okay, most of the human beings, that is common. I don't say that it is a mistake. What I am saying is to deal the class just before the lunch and after the lunch. Okay, right. The third one is also there. What is that means? The class just before the examination, particularly like your grand test, what you have today. So such a situation, this is the third case. So I will be telling very seriously all these things. So you might be living in a headache. Mostly some of you might not be even maybe seeing the class also. What class we will have it over the YouTube. Tomorrow we can see whatever. Let us prepare for that. So what did I think today? Better one solution I had. Okay, I got with the one solution. Okay. This one. Okay, I will stop up to this. Right. So in this chapter, up to this only the questions you will get. Mostly what are the questions? Bar bound density, SI unit of density, or single unit of density, relative density, whether the relative density is having any problem. So relative density will be knowing it. Okay. So this you should be very cautious. Suppose, for example, I tell you one more question. Which of the following is the unit of density? Suppose the question is coming. Okay. So you are going to get a suppose if you, okay, right, because if I say, okay, if you get a question, if, what is that, if yes, so if you get a question, like, what is the unit of density, which among the following is the unit of density, okay, so which among the following is the unit of density. So you know very well. Okay, how the question paper works. If he wants to do some tricky question, okay, if he wants to do some mind game with you, so then what will be the chances are? So for Pujar, as usual, okay, he is the power minus 3. And then second guy is mostly here this one. So grand power centimeter. And third one, mostly, okay, A and B. And last one is none, of course. So if this is the question, mostly out of enthusiasm, out of anxiety, what the students will do is, as soon as they see the science paper, okay, yeah. You should not be so over enthusiastic, over excited, over anxiety. Not necessary. So go through the next choice also at least. Okay, go through the next step. Because this is also correct. So what is the question actually here? What is the unit he is asking? Not asked for the SI unit, yes or no? Nor the CGS unit. Okay, whether SI unit also is not asked for, then CGS also not asked for, then unit is asked. So if unit means both are correct, no? So both are correct. So maybe some might be out of more anxiety, they might see only this one. They might see only this one. And both with B, that also is wrong. So you will get such questions in physics, no doubt. So better you have some patience. So then again, okay. So this is one of the this one. So regarding thermal, okay, enthusiasm, anxiety, how to reduce this anxiety. So take a deep breath before you attempt the paper physically or whether physically or online, whatever it is. So because you are going to write most of the exams online here after the your entrance examination. For example, job exams like banking exam or IIT or MCET or tomorrow, NEET, whatever it is. So you have to cool your mind yourself in the beginning.
So what are the methods to be followed? What methods can you follow? Just I will try to demonstrate the path you follow, because these are the methods which are very, very successful. Okay, that means the method followed by students who hope IIT as well as NEET or any other exams or job exams. Okay. So where the good subjects are not really safe. Okay? Right. So if it is for higher class students, it is for higher class, means what? Higher class means plus two fellows. Interview, first year or second year, no problem. And for high school students, if you have a campus like yesterday and even today also maybe, you are attending for 150 marks and 3 hours. Okay, very nice. 3 hours exam means enough of time is actually. Okay, methods. So first method what I say is, okay, your subjects, no? So you have biology, then you have physics. Okay. These are the subjects you are going to write. Okay. If it were for intermediate students, that will be either botany, zoology, physics and chemistry. So if it is maths, then it is maths, physics and chemistry. Okay. So maths, physics and chemistry. So here, if it were this, the person can do any one of these in the first place. So then go for chemistry and a last physics, which is third. So here, first go with chemistry and then with physics and then with the. So this is the order. So we don't say that this is a rule, but so if you follow this order, then it is good. Okay, it is not for you. It is for the elders, that means for plus two. Okay, coming to you. So you people have these three subjects now. So 50 marks each there. So this is for 50, this is for 50, and this is for 50. So what I hope and I suggest is, in biology, you will not have any calculation as per my knowledge. For example, problems or something like this, what you have in mathematics and physics. Okay. So what should be your selection? So whenever you get the paper, whenever you are sitting for the exam, so better you go with this subject, biology. So this is biology. Go first preference. So you attend biology courses. Okay. Then go for physics. Then go for this subject. So this is the second you have to take, and the last one better is mathematics. Okay. So why I am discussing, because today anyhow your concentration will not be there. Mostly you might be missing the class, maybe, I don't know. So to make the class interesting only, I am going this little bit. Okay, today one day this will be useful to you, so that I am discussing this one. So first preference, second preference, and this should be your third preference. So that is the best method, what I feel and what even others also suggest. Most of the experts say better you go in this pattern. Okay, first you have to better go with the biology, then another one is there, which is the first terminology. So then we have another one also. What is that? Okay, EMP method. EMD, sorry. EMD. So here, what is meant by E is nothing but easy questions. Easy. And then this one is mediocre. Or medium level of difficulty. Here I am speaking about level of difficulty. This is okay, this is difficult. Yeah. by reading the question you can understand. So you should select this one, and again in this, again what you have to follow? This one. So first easy, then this one, and then last. Go for the difficult ones in the last. So if you start with the difficult ones in the beginning, the entire thing is going this. Yes or no? If you are learning to be, okay. So this might help you. This will help you even in your future. When you go to intermediate also, when you are writing intermediate exam, or when you are writing IIT, or when you are writing NEET, MCET, whatever it is. But all it is a competitive exam. Whatever the subject may be, your preference should be like this, because IIT itself contains, okay, 40% easy, 40% easy, 40% middle. And difficulty is only 20%. And here in our exam, in my subject, if I have to speak, the difficulty level questions are only 5%, I will say. Okay, so 5% means what? Out of 100, 5 means out of 50, 2 or 3 questions. That's all. Yes, confirm. But this one, medium or easy, just by seeing the question, you can write the answer for easy questions. So this one little bit you might have to think, little thinking or little doing working on problem. For example, see, radius of curvature. So okay, see, radius of curvature of a mirror is 40 centimeter. What is the focal length? Focal length is what? So how will you calculate? Just half of this. So and you know that f is equal to r by 2. F is equal to r by 2. F is equal to 20 centimeter. Such a simple calculation. So this is coming in such a concept. Or you can place this one also. But here, why I am saying this into this means, some may not be able to remember even the formula also. That means the relation between radius of curvature and focal length. So most of the people, or most of the students. So for such people, this will fall in this category. The person who is in touch with the subject, this will be in this category. Okay. So the person who has not at all in touch, this will be difficult category. Okay. So and for your kind information, I can even tell the how much amount we forget for how many days. Suppose you learnt or you heard something today. Okay. In 1 hour you will forget 10%. In 3 hours you will forget 15%. In 18 hours. You will forget 30%, and in 1 week you will forget 70%. So if you don't study anything for 1 week, how much of the subject you forget is 70 to 80% of the subject. Let it be whoever, even if Einstein also, this is true. Forgetting curves or memory curves we call it. Okay, so this is psychology. So remember even this one also. Okay. So forgetting. When time comes, I will discuss this in detail. Okay. Now what we are discussing here? Right. So go with the easy. And again, see, you have to divide the time. Okay. So anyway, you are getting 3 hours from. So divide this in 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, and 1 hour. So in the first 1 hour, what I am saying is, go with all the 3 subjects, all the 3 easy questions. Next 1 hour, all the 3 medium. Next 1 hour. So by 2 hours, you would have completed how many questions? Nearly 100 questions. Okay, 50 plus 50. I am saying. Okay, so 100 questions already you are done, and the remaining 1 hour you can spend for remaining 50 questions. Okay, you have to divide the time like that, right? So for everything there should be a planning, otherwise we can't success. Okay, so go throughout the paper, go with the all the questions. So easy will be 40%, medium will be 40%, and mostly the difficult will be not more than 20%. So that each and every student will be able to score above 80% if you have gone through the subject earlier. Otherwise, no, because it is a grand test, I am saying. For 150 marks and 3 hours you are writing, no. So, that's why I am not discussing the subject. Okay, I am discussing this. And now, I will revise all the topics just very briefly. Okay, within very less time. So, mostly, okay, I have not gone in there. So, whatever the important topics, just I will have a brief revision in each and every chapter, starting from the first chapter, that is motion. Okay, right. So I hope you remember all these things better. So the first chapter, if you remember, that is motion. So in motion, what did we discuss? First of all, rest and motion are relative terms. So relative terms means we discussed what is a relative term? The term which depends on other term or other quantity, physical quantity which depends on other physical quantity. We say that they are relative. For example, rest and motion, length and long and tall, right and left, up and down. These are all relative terms. Okay. That is, we have discussed the first term. Okay. Then coming to motion. What is motion? When do we say that an object is moving? When do we say that an object is moving? When its position is changing with respect to time and surroundings. Okay. So we say that an object is moving and motion means when it is having like whether position of the object is changing with respect to time and surrounding. The surrounding we call it as what? Surrounding we call as reference frame. Frame of reference. Yes or no? Right. So then the concept of speed, concept of uniform speed, then uniform speed, average speed and the instantaneous speed. This is a great problem. So coming to the first chapter, that is motion. So in motion, what about we studied here in first about reference frame, or you can call it something as surrounding. Is that not right? So once we define this reference frame, then we discuss regarding rest and motion, rest comma motion. So briefly we discuss what is rest or motion. So if the position of an object does not change with respect to time and surrounding, we say that the object is at rest with respect to that surrounding. Then coming to motion, if the position of the object is changing with respect to time and surrounding, then we say that the object is in motion. Finish. So then coming to speed. Okay. So here speed means we categorize this into, okay, what is that? Uniform speed, then average speed, and then finally instantaneous speed. So if the object is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time, then we say that the body is moving in uniform speed and the average speed. Okay. Average speed, how do you define? This is the ratio of total distance in total time. Total distance traveled by the object in total time interval. And finally, here instantaneous speed means the speed of the object at a particular time interval, particular point of time. We call it as instantaneous speed. Then the same thing, we discussed the velocity also. What is velocity? So velocity is a vector. Velocity is a vector. So speed is a scalar. So the difference between vector and scalar. Okay. So here also we have what? So uniform velocity, and then average velocity, and then finally instantaneous velocity. Instantaneous velocity, right? So here we are speaking about scalar and vector. So what is scalar? Physical quantity. The physical quantity which has only magnitude but no direction, we call it as a scalar physical quantity. But if it is a vector, the physical quantity which has both magnitude and direction is called as vector physical quantity. Then the unit from this, from both of these, the unit is SI is what? Meter per second. That's all. So SI is also very important, right? So uniform velocity, average velocity, instantaneous velocity. So here, how do we find uniform velocity? Uniform velocity is defined as, okay, so if the object is covering equal displacement, here, displacement
in particular time interval. So again we come to the discussion, what is the displacement? What is displacement? What is the definition of displacement? Displacement is defined as the shortest path between the initial and the final point in a specified direction. It is called as displacement, or the directed line segment between the directed line segment between initial and final points. Okay, is called as displacement. So this is also a vector. Displacement is also a vector. So how do you define this one? Uniform velocity. So uniform velocity is defined as, okay, if the object is traveling equal displacements in equal intervals of time, then we say that it is in uniform, or it is traveling in uniform velocity. Then average velocity. So total displacement by the ratio of total displacement by the time taken for the journey. The same instantaneous velocity also. Instantaneous velocity is nothing but the velocity of the object at a particular definite time interval. Particular time interval is instantaneous velocity. Just coming to acceleration. So this is also a vector. This is also a vector. Okay. This is also a vector. So it is denoted as, or it is defined as, the rate of change of velocity. Rate of change of velocity. So again, in acceleration we had two types. Okay, one is positive acceleration, what we call that acceleration only. And then if the acceleration is negative, okay, negative acceleration or deceleration. Call it as deceleration, or otherwise retardation. So these are the few things which are very important in the first chapter. So in the second chapter, equations of motion, we have discussed it. In the second chapter, equations of motion. So these equations of motion always are applicable for what? Applicable for uniform accelerated bodies. Uniformly accelerated bodies. So that means if acceleration equal to uniform. Okay, acceleration is uniform. Means what? Velocity is variable. Velocity is variable. So here we have got only v is equal to u plus jt. S is equal to ut plus half at square. Finally, g square minus g square is equal to 2as. So plus or minus you can change that. So these are the equations of motion we have studied in the next chapter. Other than this acceleration or it is negative, that is deceleration. So examples also we have discussed. Okay, example for a body which is accelerating, which is decelerating. Accelerating means increasing velocity with the time. Decelerating means decreasing velocity with the time. Of course, these derivations are not important, only these equations are important. Just if you remember this, that is more than enough. Okay. Then we came to the second or third chapter, that is matter of flow. Okay. Right. Newton's laws. Then the laws of motion, of course. So after this we have discussed about, so after this laws of motion, so laws of motion, Newton's first law, okay, what does Newton's first law say? Newton's first law said that an object at rest or in uniform motion continues to do so unless any external force acts on it. So from the Newton's first law we get the concept of inertia. What is inertia? The ability or the inability of an object to change its state of rest or motion by itself is called as inertia. This is of totally three types: inertia of rest, inertia of motion, inertia of direction. So totally three concepts of inertia from the first law. So inertia of rest means the inability of the object to come into motion by itself, means the object is initially at rest. It cannot come into motion by itself. So this property of the object is called inertia of rest. Next, inertia of motion. So what is inertia of motion? The inability of an object to come to rest by itself means initially the object is in motion,
the object which is in motion cannot come to rest by itself. Okay, this property is called as inertia of inertia of motion, right? The third one, inertia of direction, the inability of an object to change its direction by itself. So when you are negotiating a turn, okay, your motion will be in one direction, but you will fall along the opposite direction when an object is negotiating a curve where you are not able to change your direction by yourself or an object by itself. That means the inability of an object to change its direction by itself is called as inertia of direction. So then the second law, the rate of change of acceleration is directly proportional to the force acting on that object and takes place in the direction of the force. This is the Newton's second law. Newton's second law or mathematically can be expressed as F is equal to ma.
So Newton's second law, F is equal to mathematical representation of Newton's second law is F is equal to ma. Mathematical representation only.
I'm not saying Newton's second law is F is equal to ma. No, mathematical representation of Newton's second law, because statement is there. Statement is there, but this is the mathematical representation of Newton's second law. So before discussing this one, we have another concept also called as impulse. Sorry, momentum. Linear momentum. Because the concept called as momentum. This is the property of a moving object. The property of a moving object. That is nothing but momentum. It is nothing but the product of mass and velocity of a object. Mass and velocity of a object. And then finally, we have what is the name? Newton's third law. That is nothing but every object acts, every object exerts a force on other object, which is called as action. In turn, the other object also exerts a force on the first object, which is called as reaction, which is in the opposite direction. Action, reaction. Okay, so reaction occurs in the opposite direction to the action. So we write action equal to minus reaction. So here we discuss even the law of conservation of momentum also. Okay, law of conservation of momentum means if two objects are traveling in a particular direction and if they hit together, okay, the initial momentum is equal to final momentum. Initial momentum is equal to final momentum, right? So that is about law of conservation of momentum. So these are about the laws. So in the last part we discuss impulse. Okay, what is impulse? The product of force and time, we call it as impulse. Or the force is impulsive force. So examples we have taken, the person who is catching a ball, a cricket player who is catching a ball, okay, after he catches, he pulls the hand in a direction behind him, or he just pulls the hand away for a while. So thereby what he is doing is, the force exerted by the ball on his hand, okay, will be reduced, and the time will increase. I is equal to F equal to T, no? So I is equal to F equal to T. So if you increase the time, the force will increase, okay, comparatively reduced. Okay, so another example is, throwing or just dropping an egg on a concrete floor, and the same egg if you are dropping onto a pillow, very smooth cushioned pillow. Okay, so in the first case, that means when the egg is falling on the concrete floor, the egg gets broken because the reaction time is very less, force is more. But the same thing when it is happening onto the pillow, smooth cushioned pillow, okay, that will not break because the egg is having some action. That means the impulsive time is increased so that the force which is acting is comparatively reduced so that the egg will not break. So these are some examples for impulse. Okay. In the next chapter, what is the name? He is man of view. Okay then. Okay. He is man of view. So in this chapter, we have discussed what are mixtures and what are the first of all few substances and then mixtures. So here he is man of view. In this we have discussed regarding mixtures and pure substances. So under pure substances we have one solution, homogeneous solution, and the heterogeneous solution. So, homogeneous solution means the solution will be uniform flow. For example, you mix some lemonade. Okay, lemonade is the mixture of salt plus sugar plus water. Okay, if you stir it and mix it thoroughly, then the taste is same to both. Okay, these are, you call it as homogeneous solution. Then heterogeneous solution is what? The solution is do not mix up together. For example, sand and water, or mud and water, or chalk powder and chalk piece powder and water. So these we call it as heterogeneous mixtures. Okay, awesome. And then separation of mixtures. So up to this chapter, means this is math pure, you have already written many exams. So most of the questions are not from this. Just because you revise that, it will more bad enough. Okay. So coming to is matter pure. Is matter pure. So in this we have, okay, pure substances, and then mixture. So in mixtures, okay, pure substances means we have elements. Okay, compounds, etc. But if you come to this one, mixtures again types we have. So homogeneous mixture, homogeneous mixture under heterogeneous mixture. So in other type of classification, we have colloids and then emulsions. And then Tyndall effect. What is Tyndall effect? The scattering. That means when light is entering from a very small aperture or a hole, okay, it scatters in such a way, or the light gets redistributed. That means the shining or the quantity or the intensity of light changes. This is what is called as Tyndall effect. So finally, elements and compounds we have. So finally, we have elements and then compounds. So after this, we have discussed what the next chapter after this is. Okay, so that is nothing but what is inside the atoms and the molecules. So after this, we had atoms and molecules. Atoms and the molecules. So finally, here the smallest substance in the universe is atom. So atom theory, or otherwise, we discussed this. What is it? Law of conservation of matter. Or law of conservation of what? What is this one? Matter. That means here we discussed one experiment. Okay. So in chemical reactions, the atoms are neither created nor destroyed. Okay. The experiment done by whom and all. And again by? Developed by. Okay. Lavoisier, okay. So Lavoisier's experiment we have discussed. So then Dalton. So then we came to the Dalton's atomic theory. So John Dalton. So Dalton's atomic theory. And then the changes one by one. So once the Dalton has proposed, okay, 3 or 4 postulates, and then it was later on changed by some other scientist. Okay. So here you have learned three. So in this chapter you got some, okay, names of elements, which is important. Names of elements here. Some elements are having Latin names. Okay, so for example, sodium. If you take sodium, the symbol is, sodium symbol is Na, but its Latin name is natrium. The same thing to take potassium. Potassium symbol is K. Potassium symbol is K, and its Latin name is Calium. Okay, like that you got immigration symbols of elements here and the Latin names. So Latin names you have to go through. So sodium is natrium, potassium is calcium, and then tin is sin, stannum. Okay, similarly tungsten, the what is that one? The metal used in the bulbs, that is tungsten. So tungsten Latin name is, okay, what is that one? Wolfram. Symbol is W. Okay, this is tungsten. Tungsten is the common name, and the wolfram is the Latin name. Okay, Latin name. So here in this chapter, Latin names are important and symbols are important. How is mercury? What is the symbol of mercury? Mercury symbol. Because the word mercury is starting with M, but the symbol is Hg. Symbol is Hg, which means actually again hydrogram. symbol is microgram, which is the symbol of mercury is Mg. So like that, you have to go through the Latin and Greek chapter, and then the formulae. Okay, formula of water, H2O, formula of carbon dioxide, CO2, etc., etc. Like that in this chapter. So then we get into what is inside that. Subatomic particle. So atomicity. And then the formula. Okay. So then coming to, okay, here one more important thing, mole concept. So you have to go through mole concept also. What is one mole? So from which we have derived this mole concept. So what is the standard? Standard for expressing the weights of elements. The standard unit for expressing the weights of elements. So the weights of all the elements are relative weights. Relative weights. They are compared with the 1/12 of weight of 1/12 of carbon 12 isotope. So once you are saying isotope, what is an isotope? The elements with the same atomic number but different atomic weights are called as isotope. So what is the difference? Here means the difference will be there in the neutron number. Neutron number means the number of neutrons in an atom. So here neutron number, that means the atomic weight is different but the atomic number is same. We call such element, that means mostly same elements. Okay, carbon 12, carbon 13, atomic number of carbon is 6, weight is, okay, one of the isotope weight is 12, another isotope will be 13, similarly nitrogen, similarly oxygen. Okay, so here this is also important in this chapter. So next if we go to the what is inside the atom. So what is inside the atom? Subatomic particles, you have to concentrate. So most of the questions generally, how will come? Who discovered a proton? Who discovered a neutron? Who discovered electron? What is the charge of electron? Charge of proton? Charge of neutron? So these are all important. Okay. Then, which of the subatomic particles means among protons, neutrons, and electrons? Okay. Among protons, neutrons, and electrons. So which of them will be within the nucleus? Which will be outside the nucleus? So this already you have written. But once again, I am reminding you because it is very important. Okay, so such questions, so you have to concentrate on this area. And again, when you go to what is inside the atom, models, atomic models, okay, starting from the Dalton model. So after Dalton, who has given the atomic model for us? It is Thomson. Okay, Thomson gave us the model. Okay, then after Thomson, who was the person? Thomson, what was the model given to Thomson? Atomic model. Okay, watermelon model. Okay, right. So after this, who was the person to modify Thomson's model was? It was his student only, that is nothing but Rutherford. Okay, Rutherford's atomic model is also called as, okay, two names are there for that. So one is the planetary model, you can say, another one is nuclear model. Because for the first time, he was the person to identify that in an atom, there will be a space in the center called as nucleus, in which the subatomic particles, like protons and neutrons will be present. The entire mass, okay, in the entire mass of the atom, more than 90% of the mass is due to the nucleus, which contains protons and neutrons. The remaining the electrons that are revolving around the nucleus. Okay, then after this one, even Rutherford's model was also not completely correct. So for this, the modification was done by Bohr, Niels Bohr. Okay, so Niels Bohr. And again modified by Sommerfeld. Again modified by Sommerfeld. So with that, our atomic, that means what is inside the atom, the chapter will end. So this area you have to concentrate. So the next comes our, what is that? Chemical equations and inequations. So number of questions you have written chemical equations and equations. So I did not make you struggle with those. So just go on, just you go through the equations. Okay, just what are the types of equations? That means chemical combination reaction, then displacement reactions, then decomposition reactions, and finally double decomposition reactions, and then finally just balancing. Just you go through what is the method, how to balance. That's all. So in chemical equations and reactions, not much questions. Okay, you need not worry that much. No problem. In that also, I did not ask problems also this time, right? So you can skip off that chapter also. Finally, we have optics. Finally, we have reflection of light under cloud circulation. So, in reflection of light under cloud circulation, so what you have to concentrate is, first go through the formula. Okay, what is the formula we have? Suppose, see, I will mention one person here. It is regulation, okay, mirror formula, which are the following is mirror formula. Okay, right. So, mirror formula is all the derivative. 1 by x equal to 1 by u plus 1
can modify this also, the same thing. See, if you do this HCM, this also can be written as U E by U plus V also. And also the same thing can be written as, okay, this. Therefore, F is equal to U V by U plus V. So if you have all these three choices, then all the things will be correct. So be careful with this one. And the relation between radius of curvature and focal R is equal to 2L. F is equal to R by 2. So very simple problems. Okay, on based on this. And again, for the different positions of the object before the concave mirror, different positions of the object before the concave mirror, what where the image is produced or where the image is formed and what are the characteristics of that image. So in this one today, what are the important cases mean? One is when the object is placed between pole and focus, you get a virtual image. And the next one is when the object is at the center of curvature, the image also falls at center of curvature. No change in the size of the image, but it comes inverted. Object is erected, image will be inverted. That's all. Right. So these are the very, very important cases among all the cases when the object is placed before the mirror. So finally, gravitation. So in gravitation, centripetal force or centripetal acceleration, and centripetal acceleration, V square by R formula, A is equal to V square by R. So centripetal force, F is equal to mv square by r, right? So just go through whatever I have told now. You will write your exam in an excellent manner. Just to follow the things also, you are going to write your exam very excellently.
Yes.
So thank you for listening this revision. And tomorrow, okay, we will start our topic, right? So have a good day and write your exam very well. Those who have not written,